The sky calls to us. If we do not destroy ourselves, we will one day venture to the stars. There was a time when the stars seemed an impenetrable mystery. Today, we have begun to understand them. In our personal lives also, we journey from ignorance to knowledge. Our individual growth reflects the advancement of the species. The exploration of the cosmos is a voyage of self-discovery. When I was a child, I lived here, in the Bensonhurst section of Brooklyn, in the city of New York. I knew my immediate neighborhood intimately. Every candy store, front stoop, backyard, empty lot, and wall for playing Chinese handball. It was my whole world. But more than a few blocks away, north of the raucous traffic and elevated railway on 86th Street, was an unknown territory, off limits to my wanderings. It could have been Mars for all I knew. Even with an early bedtime in the winter, you could occasionally see the stars. I would look up at them and wonder what they were. I'd ask other kids and adults, and they would answer, "There are lights in the sky, kid." Well, I could tell there were lights in the sky, but what were they? There had to be some deeper answer. I remember I was issued my first library card. I think it was some library over there on 85th Street. Anyway, it was in alien territory. And I asked the librarian for a book on stars. She gave me a funny kind of picture book with portraits of men and women with names like Veronica Lake and Alan Ladd. I explained that wasn't what I wanted at all. And for some reason then obscure to me, she smiled and got me another book, the right kind of book. I was so excited to know the answer that I opened the book breathlessly right there in the library. And the book said something astonishing, a very big thought. Stars, it said, were suns, but very far away. The sun was a star, but close up. How, I wondered, could anybody know such things for sure? How did they figure it out? Where did they even begin? I was ignorant of the idea of angular size. I didn't know a thing about the inverse square law of the propagation of light. I didn't have the ghost of a chance of calculating the distance to the stars. But I could tell that if the stars were suns, they had to be awfully far away, further away than 86th Street, further away than Manhattan, further away, probably, than New Jersey. The universe had become much grander than I had ever guessed. And then I read another astonishing fact. The Earth, which includes Brooklyn, was a planet. It went around the sun. There were other planets. They also went around the sun, some closer to the sun, some further from the sun. But planets didn't shine by their own light the way the sun does. No, planets simply reflected the little bit of light that shines on them from the sun back to us. If you were a great distance away from the sun, you wouldn't be able to see the Earth or the other planets at all. Well, then, it stood to reason, I thought, that those other stars ought to have their own planets. And some of those planets ought to have life. Why not? And that life ought to be pretty different from life as we know it. Life here in Brooklyn.
Ganymede, look at this amazing Ganymede stuff. Wait, I want to give to people who
As a child, it was my immense good fortune to have parents and a few teachers who encouraged my curiosity. This was my sixth grade classroom. I came back here one afternoon to remember what it was like. I brought some of the breathtaking pictures of other worlds that had been radioed back by the Voyager spacecraft in their encounters with Jupiter and its moons.
Okay, this is Callisto, which is... What is a Callisto? I want a Callisto. Now you got it. What is it? It's the outermost big moon of Jupiter. Who is this guy? Europa. Another Europa. A black and white picture of a ring of Jupiter. There you go. That's a prize for honesty. You didn't get a second. You're right. Which one would you like? Okay. No. You didn't get a second.
Every one of us begins life with an open mind, a driving curiosity, a sense of wonder.
It might be fun if we now had some questions.
Why is the Earth round? Why isn't it square or any other shape?
That's a good question. I like that question. It's a question I have asked myself. And the answer has to do with gravity. The Earth has a strong gravity. If you were to make a mountain very high, higher than Everest, you know, it's the biggest mountain on the Earth, it would be crushed by its own weight. You see, gravity pulls everything towards the center. So any really big bump on the Earth is crushed. But if you had a small object, a tiny world, the gravity is very low, and then it can be very different from a sphere. I think I have here a world that isn't a sphere. Here. Look at this one. See? It's lumpy. It's a lumpy world. It looks like a potato, right? There's a large potato orbiting the planet Mars. This is one of the moons of Mars. And that's a perfect example of it. You can have big departures from a sphere if your gravity is low. Now, a question in the front. Okay.
Is the sun considered part of the Milky Way galaxy?
Sure. You're considered part of the Milky Way galaxy. Everything except other galaxies is part of the Milky Way galaxy. The sun is one star. There is a few hundred billion stars in the Milky Way. And around each star, maybe, it's a whole bunch of planets. And on one of those planets is life. And one of the life forms on that planet is you. So you're a part of the Milky Way galaxy, too.
Sometimes I think, how lucky we are to live in this time, the first moment in human history when we are, in fact, visiting other worlds and engaging in a deep reconnaissance of the cosmos. But if we had been born in a much earlier age, no matter how great our dedication, we could not have understood what the stars and planets are. We would not have known that there were other suns and other worlds. This is one of the great secrets, wrested from nature through a million years of patient observation and courageous thinking.
Human beings have always asked questions about the stars. It's as natural as breathing. But imagine a time before science had found out the answers. Imagine what it was like, say, hundreds of thousands of years ago, soon after the discovery of fire. We were just as smart and just as curious then as we are now. Sometimes it seems to me that there were people then who thought like this.
We are wandering hunter folk. Fire keeps us warm. Its light makes holes in the darkness. It keeps hungry animals away. In the darkness,
we can see each other and talk. We take care of the flame. The flame takes care of us. The stars are not near to us. When we climb a hill or a tree, they are no closer. They flicker with a strange, cold, white, faraway light. Many of them, all over the sky, but only at night. I wonder what they are. One night I thought, the stars are flames. They give a little light at night, as fire does. Maybe the stars are campfires, which other wanderers light at night. The stars give a much smaller light than campfires, so they must be very far away. I wonder if our campfires look like stars to the people in the sky. But why don't those campfires and the wanderers who made them fall down at our feet? Why don't strange tribes drop from the sky? Those beings in the sky must have great powers.
I don't suppose that every hunter-gatherer had such thoughts about the stars, but we know from contemporary hunter-gatherer communities that very imaginative ideas arise. The Bushmen of the Kalahari Desert in the Republic of Botswana have an explanation of the Milky Way. At their latitude, it's often overhead. They call it the backbone of night. They believe it holds the sky up. They believe that if not for the Milky Way, pieces of sky would come crashing down at our feet. So the Milky Way, in their view, has some practical value, the backbone of night. Later on, metaphors about campfires or backbones or holes through which the flame could be seen were replaced in most human communities by another idea. The powerful beings in the sky were promoted to gods. They were given names and relatives and special responsibilities for the cosmic services they were expected to perform. There was a god for every human concern. Gods ran nature. Nothing happened without the direct intervention of some god. If the gods were happy, there was plenty of food, and humans were happy. But if something displeased the gods, and it didn't take much, the consequences were awesome. Droughts, floods, storms, wars, earthquakes, volcanic eruptions, epidemics. The gods had to be propitiated, and a vast industry of priests arose to make the gods less angry. But because the gods were capricious, you couldn't be sure what they would do. Nature was a mystery. It was hard to understand the world. Our ancestors groped in darkness to make sense of their surroundings. Powerless before nature, they invented rituals and myths, some desperate and cruel, others imaginative and benign. The ancient Greeks explained that diffuse band of brightness in the night sky as the milk of the goddess Hera squirted from her breast across the heavens. We still call it the Milky Way.